image that needs a touch from you tonight, God. And we ask, Holy Spirit, that you would pour out a healing amongst them, in their minds, in their hearts, in their souls, in their bodies. God, that you would touch them in a miraculous way, Father, that they would sense your hand of comfort, that they would sense your hand of healing, that they would sense, Father, that you are with them and that you are for them, God, and that you would just strengthen them from the inside out right now, right now, right now, right now. Nothing is impossible for you. And we rejoice, Father, that you are the God of our salvation. You are the God of our salvation. And we give you praise in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen, amen, and amen. Come on, praise God for a moment, won't you? He is so good. So good. Do me a favor. Turn around. Greet someone. Give somebody a hug, give someone a high five. Welcome them to Wednesday night service. Got somebody's phone here. Lord. Well, how many can say it's good to be in God's house? Amen? Come on, we can be more excited than that. More excitement meant three more people. All right. Praise God. Praise God. Well, I want to welcome you, church, to Wednesday night service. I'm Pastor Moses, one of the pastors privileged and honored to lead this community we call All People's Church, because we believe God is calling all people to himself. Amen? Amen. And if you're tuning in online, we do want to welcome you. Thank you for tuning in. Tonight we're starting a brand new series called When Life Gives You Lemons. And before we get started, I do just want to make a few quick announcements. I want to let the parents in the room know that we have a sports camp starting next week, Monday, and that you can still sign up for that. And if you need to sign up for that, just speak to Angie at the guest services, even on a Sunday morning, or you can call in and we can get you registered and signed up for that as well. And we're excited for the summer. How many people are excited for the summer? It sounds like you want the winter to be back. Come on, how many people are excited for the summer? Yeah. I am incredibly excited for the summer. Speaking of the summer, we have some incredible summer students helping us out this summer. And so I don't know if they're all in the room, but we have Azen, we've got Renee, she's sitting back there, Patricia, Morgan, who's behind the camera there today, Luigi and Emily, and they are just awesome. Come on, give it up for them. And so we're excited to be able to put them to work this summer. Amen. Come on, it's a good thing. It's a good thing. So we're going to get started tonight, and I just want to kind of share a little bit that's on my heart in regards to why doing a series like this. Oftentimes, I find myself praying, and I mean, how many know that's a good thing, to find yourself praying, amen? And asking the question, because sometimes it's so easy to go into the mode of, where is my thought pattern been recently? And sometimes what ends up happening as a preacher, as a pastor, and leaders in churches is oftentimes we feel like what we need is the same thing the body needs. And that's often not the case. And so I try to pray, okay, Lord, what is it that you're telling me that the people need? Where are people at in our body, in our congregation, in our gathering, in our community? What do they need? And how many were here for our John 15 series, Abiding? A few of you. Okay, that's awesome. And so it was really out of that series that I wanted to do something on trials. How many of you remember the cycle of abiding? Yeah, you remember that? And so the first thing that we're called to do is what? Abide in Christ. And then second thing that follows after that is Christ abides in us. And then as a result of us abiding in Christ and Christ abiding in us, what do? We bear fruit. And then Jesus says, the Father, who is the vine dresser, comes and he prunes us, right? And so here comes the pruning process. And how many know, as we discussed when we went through this series, that pruning is difficult? That pruning is not always a joyous thing, yet how many know that it is absolutely necessary? Amen. I see two hands up there. Praise God. And how many know that it's only until after we are pruned by the Father, who is our gardener, our vine dresser, that we bear something called much more fruit? And it is only then that the Father is glorified. And so oftentimes, and we talked about this, and I just want to do a quick little recap, is that we reach the moment where we bear fruit because we abide in Christ. Christ abides in us. We bear fruit. And the Father comes to prune us. And because we are under discomfort and we are under situations and circumstances that we would rather not be in because things are not really easy for us in those moments, oftentimes what we do is we kind of step back from fully following Jesus, from fully trusting him, from fully expressing our faith in him, and we stop the process of pruning. And we don't realize that when we stop the process of pruning, we are stopping the next two important steps after that, which is that we bear much more fruit, and also that the Father is glorified. Which tells me that until I let the Father prune me, I can't let him be glorified through me. Amen? Is anyone out here tonight on a Wednesday night? And so, really, this study came out of my own experience and my interaction with Christians and with the body of Christ. And I understood, and what I felt the Lord was saying to me is a lot of people don't know how to walk through trials. A lot of people don't know how to hold still so that the Father would prune them. And so really, this series is on how do we navigate through trials, and how do we navigate through difficult circumstances that God either, by his sovereignty, chooses for us to go through or that he allows us to go through. For obviously the purpose of maturing and becoming more like Jesus. Amen? Amen. So how many are ready to get started? So we're going to read two scriptures. We're going to be in Romans chapter 5, verses 1 to 5. And James chapter 1, verses 2 to 4. That's Romans 5, 1 to 5, and James 1, 2 to 4. As you find your way there, let me pray. Father, thank you for the moments that we share and the space that you've created. And God, we just ask that you would be so involved in everything that gets done tonight. Lord, with the words that I say and everything that is discussed here tonight, and even as we navigate through these scriptures that may be hard for us to digest, Holy Spirit, I pray that you would help us become our teacher tonight. Lead us into all truth tonight and glorify the name of Jesus that is above every other name. Amen. So Romans chapter 5, verses 1 to 5. Are we there? Awesome. So Paul is writing, he says here, therefore, Romans chapter 5, 1 to 5, he says, therefore, since we have been justified by God, justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus, Through him, we also have obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand. And we rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Not only that, but we rejoice in our suffering, knowing that our suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. James chapter 1, verses 2 to 4, he writes, "Count it all joy, my brothers and sisters, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness, and let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing." Amen. How many of you have ever experienced the amazing thrill of drinking a cold glass of lemonade on a hot day? Just a few of you have been blessed enough to enjoy that. It is one of the most refreshing and exhilarating things to do. On a hot, sweaty, sticky summer day, you drink a cold glass of lemonade. And how many know that in order to make lemonade, you essentially need three ingredients? How many know what they are? Water, lemons, and sugars. How many know that if you just mix lemon and water, all you're left with is lemon water? And that you need sugar to give it that sweet and refreshing taste. Otherwise, it's just going to be gross. We were at a restaurant just a few weeks ago, and the gentleman serving us approached us, asking us if we want any drinks before we have our meals. And he says, "I want to tell you that we have the best lemonade in the world." We said, "Oh, really?" He said, "Oh, yeah." I said, "I don't trust you." He said, "Please do." And we said, "Okay, fine. We'll put you to the test. Bring us the world's best lemonade." And he brought us these big, massive glasses of lemonade. And on top of the drink and the ice was a lemon peel coated in sugar. And I drank it, and it was the best lemonade that I have ever had. And so I trust that man with my life now. Why not? Now, here's what we need to understand, that life often gives us difficult situations and circumstances that are sour. And we have the opportunity to make something more palatable out of the lemons life gives us. And what we need to understand is that when life gives us tough circumstances, oftentimes, they look like this, where sugar is in one container, water is in the other, and lemons, well, you have to cut them open. And then you have this thing, which squeezes the lemon juice out of the lemon. And when life presents us with this, oftentimes we are confused and we are conflicted as to what to do with everything life has just presented us. And we ask God questions, which are important questions, I believe, like, what am I supposed to do with all of this? How many of you have ever asked God that question? What am I supposed to do with all of this? And I just want to navigate us through some scripture tonight, Romans 5 and James 1. And my hope is that we would see that there is a process that we need to walk through when life gives us lemons in order for us to make lemonade. In other words, there is a purpose behind the suffering. There is a purpose behind the pain. There is a purpose behind the trials. And can I tell you that suffering loses its sting the moment it finds meaning? And oftentimes, the sourness and the sour taste in our mouth is left there because we haven't really understood the biblical meaning and purposes of why we're going through what we're going through. But we're going to get through that. Amen? And so let's just walk through Romans chapter 5 here. He says, "Therefore, we have been justified by faith. We have peace with God through faith. And so I want you to understand that peace starts with Christ. Somebody say, peace starts with Christ. And faith is the means to get there. And so there is a process that helps us in moments where we have lost our peace to get back to the peace. And an important and very important lesson is that we need to understand that peace is a person. Peace is not a circumstance. Peace is not a situation. Peace is not a relationship with somebody. Peace is a person, and his name is Jesus. How many can say amen to that? And so Paul says that faith gives us access into this grace in which we now stand. And in other words, what he is saying is that faith gives us access to have the ability to have peace in any circumstance. Here's what you need to understand about peace. You're not responsible for making it. Tell your neighbor, you're not responsible. You're not responsible for making peace, but you are responsible for enjoying it. Did you catch that? If Christ, the person, is peace and he is inside of you, he is everywhere you go, you're not responsible to create the peace of Christ, but you are responsible to enjoy it. So what we need to do is become followers of Jesus who change our ability to think, who change our ability to see things from a negative perspective and ask God for his wisdom, his insight, and ask him, what are you trying to do? What are you trying to accomplish here that I cannot see with my natural eyes? And then he says something very interesting. He says, therefore, rejoice. Rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. What is he saying here? He's saying that one day all these trials, all these sufferings, all these pains will be over because we are justified with God. We have peace with God through Jesus. And one day we will get to spend eternity with the eternal one, where there will be no more tears, no more pain, no more suffering. We will have new bodies. There will be no need for keto diets. Someone say amen to that. There will be a new heaven, a new earth, and all we need will flow from Jesus, and we will serve him and serve one another perfectly. Rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. But before we can settle down in that pattern of thought, Paul changes the lens. There in verse 3, he says, but also rejoice in suffering. Meaning, don't get so caught up with what is to come with the glory of God when Christ appears and we will be with him in the new heaven and new earth. And he says, don't get so caught up in that, because what you can do is develop an escapism mentality. And how many of you have either been guilty of being this person or know this person where you are going through a hard time and all you seem to think about, all you seem to pray about, all you seem to focus on is, Jesus, when are you coming back? Come on, how many of you have ever been guilty of that? Where you just can't wait for the Lord to return so you can leave this earth and just be with him in glory. And though that sounds like a good thing, that is not God's plan for us. And so Paul says, before you can settle in this escapism mentality, I want to tell you that you are also to rejoice in your sufferings. And now there's a few things that we need to know here, because he gives us this formula here. Do you guys see that there in verse 3 on onward? He says, not only that, but we rejoice in our suffering, knowing that suffering produces endurance. And endurance produces character. And character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame. And so let's just say all those things one more time. He says, first of all, you need to know. Right? And what's the first thing that he says? You need to know what? Suffering. What does suffering do? It produces. does it produce? Endurance. Am I right? What does endurance produce? Character, hope. And hope does not put us to. Let's walk through each of these and talk about their importance. Is that all right? Okay, so first thing he tells us is that you are to know these things. And the knowing here refers to a knowledge acquired through reflecting or thinking. In other words, don't just go through something. But ask the questions, why am I going through this? And what does it mean that God is allowing me to go through it? Amen? He says, knowing, you are to reflect and you are to think through this. And as you do this, you are to know that suffering produces something. Now, suffering, if you're taking notes, is an oppressive state of physical, mental, social, or economic adversity. Let me repeat that. It's an oppressive state of physical, mental, social, or economic adversity. In other words, it captures everything of life. So, family drama, your mental drama that you've got in your own mind, social drama, financial drama, every sort of thing is found in this one word. All sorts of suffering, he says, produces endurance. Now, another translation actually says produces steadfast endurance. And this is going to get interesting, but I want to give you all these definitions first. So steadfast endurance is the power to withstand hardship or stress, especially the inward fortitude necessary. The power to withstand hardship or stress, especially with the inward fortitude that is necessary. In other words, it is building something inside of you. One person said that endurance is the ability to have consistency through adversity. The ability to have consistency through adversity. And I find that that is an incredibly important thing, because oftentimes when followers of Christ are faced with trials and faced with hard times, all of a sudden their consistency just drops. They stop reading the Bible as much as they used to. They stop praising God as much as they used to. You ever find that whenever maybe you're like this, because I'm like this, where you just sing spontaneous songs to God, wherever you are, in the car, when you're brushing your teeth all the time, and then when you're going through a hard season, do you find yourself that you stop singing as much? Because you lose that consistency, but we're going to talk about how to get it back. And then he says that steadfast endurance builds character. Now, character is defined as dependability. It is the quality of being proven to be dependable or reliable. Now, this is very interesting, because James says, in James chapter 1, he says, "Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. Let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing." And Paul is saying here, he's saying you are to rejoice in your suffering because you know that your suffering is producing something inside of you. And it is actually making you more dependable. Which tells me, church, that this is a necessary process to go through. That there are moments in your life that until you learn to go through some things, God is not willing to trust you with bigger and higher levels of things. And so remember, we talked about the cycle of abiding. That until we let Jesus, until we let, the Father as the vine dresser, as the gardener, prune us, we actually can't get to bearing much more fruit. And so what Paul is saying here is if you don't learn the meaning of suffering, if you don't learn to rejoice in suffering, if you don't understand what the godly biblical purpose of suffering is that you are stopping yourself from building character, which is God actually depending on you for his purposes and his plans in your life. And then he says character produces hope, and hope is a reasonable and confident expectation of a future event. In other words, when we go through suffering, we need to know that we are going through suffering. Does that make sense? That we are not to stay there. There may be seasons, there may be moments, but suffering is not a lifetime state that God wants us to be in. It is something that he wants us to walk through. We're going to talk about this next week where the psalmist says, though I walk through the valley, shadow and death, I shall fear no evil, for you are. And then he says something very interesting. He says, and hope doesn't put us to shame. And I asked the question, what does shame have to do with suffering? Because oftentimes we don't equate the two. And as I pondered and I thought about my own experiences where I have felt that I've gone through some trials, and maybe you can relate with this as you have gone through some trials, but I've noticed that when I don't understand God's purpose of suffering, I tend to tell myself things like, God can't use me anymore. And so shame overtakes because it negates the reality of hope. That is, that I will walk through this and become a better, dependable person in Christ Jesus. And so shame tells us God could have used me before this happened. God could have used me before I got a divorce. God could have used me before I lost my job. God could have used me before I had this blow up. God could have used me before I slept with that person. God could have used me before I got that abortion. God could have, and we tell ourselves all of these things. And we are covered with shame. But the Bible tells us that when the hope of God is in us, shame shall not override you because the love of God has overrode you. And so if the love of God has been poured out, and how many know that it has been poured out in a fashion that is in excess, meaning it has been given to us way more than we actually need. It is lavished upon us. And so what Paul is saying here is make no mistake that as you go through suffering, understand that whatever circumstances you face or face you, understand that there is a hope that is in you that is greater than the circumstances you face. And do not let the suffering, the trials, the mishaps, the circumstances, the loss of opportunities tell you that you are any less than what God calls you to be, which is his child, his son, his heir, a royal priesthood. And so we rejoice in our suffering. There is a word that I left out, and that is the word produces. And we're going to get to that, but I want to go through what James kind of tells us here. And James tells us, and his language is very interesting because he commands us to count it all joy, which I find very interesting. Like, James, why not just suggest it? Like why make it difficult for us? Like, how can you command joy? Right? How can you just say, if I'm walking around all sad, all upset, the last thing I want is somebody coming up to me and say, hey, brother, I want you to know that How many know that I'm not going to be counted in all joy? Amen? And so he commands us. He's saying, take up a joyful attitude when you face trials. I want you to have joy in a situation that would say that it is the most unnatural thing for you to do. And I've realized in following Jesus, I've realized that sometimes natural problems require unnatural solutions. And so as the Bible tells us, do not walk by sight, but walk by faith, what we need to understand is that there are unseen things in God that we have the ability in any moment, in any circumstance, to tap into, but the responsibility falls on us. Again, like I said earlier, it's not our responsibility to make up the peace of Christ, but it is our responsibility to enjoy the peace of Christ. When the Bible says that at his right hand there are pleasures forevermore, it must tell me that I need to get to where his right hand is. It tells me that I need to come to an understanding that Christ is seated at the right hand, and I in Christ am deemed valuable. Though I was unworthy, though I was a sinner, I am made justified, just if I had never sinned before because of Christ, because of who he is, and I have been given a new identity. And so whatever I walk through now does not change that. And the word trials that he used, and some of you who have studied scripture and studied James, you'd probably know that he's actually talking about the process of refining gold and refining silver under fire. And so the process would be that they would put it under fire and all of the impurities would begin to rise up. One person said that as we go through trials and let our faith be tested, it's almost like a mirror. Like we are a mirror, and as we are tested, all of the impurities come up, and we allow God to clean that mirror so that we can shine as the light of Christ. And so he's talking about being purified. Douglas Moo, who's a New Testament theologian, he said, therefore, suffering is a means by which faith, tested in the fire of adversity, can be purified of any junk and thereby strengthened. Which tells me, church, that trials don't determine whether I have faith. Trials do not determine. And here's what you need to understand. You cannot just tell yourself or allow others to tell you just because you are going through a hard time and that is an indication that you don't have faith in God. That is a lie, and that is very unbiblical. And if you study the Bible, you will find out that one of the primary means of sanctification, which is the Holy Spirit's work in us to make us more like Jesus, the primary means of sanctification often in Scripture is suffering. It is not prosperity. It is not promotion. It is trials and tribulation. And so trials don't determine whether I have faith. Trials strengthen the faith that I present. Now, this is incredibly important because I want to read to you again what James says. Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness, which tells me, church, that faith must be used in order for it to be tested. Did you catch that? That I can't actually squeeze this and expect to make lemonade if the lemon is not in there. I can't get a gym membership and after a year of not going, complain that I don't look any different. And so James says, it's the testing of your faith. And here's what I find. This is where people lose in terms of the pruning process, is when they face a moment or a circumstance that God either creates or allows in their life, what happens is they think just because they're in it, they're being developed. That is not true. And this is why you'll see people who have been through so many hardships, and it's like they go through hardship after hardship after hardship, and yet they're not any more mature in Christ. And so he says the testing of your faith, which tells me, church, that in moments of trials, in moments of hardship, I actually have to learn to apply God's truth to my life. Does that make sense? In other words, lemons must be squeezed. And if I am expecting to make lemonade without squeezing the lemon, that I'm not only being illogical, but I'm also not understanding the process of growth called maturity. And testing is the primary means that God uses to mature us in Christ. So he says, therefore, I need to respond to trials with joy because I know that they are working to produce a deeper, a stronger, a more certain faith inside of me. He says there's two goals, that we become mature and that we become complete. In other words, that we become all that God wants us to be. I heard one preacher say that there is a you that you haven't met yet and God wants you to introduce you to him. God wants to introduce you to her, a more fortified you, a more courageous you, a more mature you that God wants you to introduce you to. And you cannot become more mature, church, without going through some things. And the question we need to ask here then is what if God wants to accomplish something in you more than he wants to accomplish something through you? And what if the only way of accomplishing that thing is bringing you through something that is beyond you? It reminds me of Peter. How many know the story where the disciples are on the Sea of Galilee? They're in the ship, and Jesus says, "Hey, don't worry, you go. I'll catch up with you." And Jesus begins to walk on water like it's normal. And they think it's a ghost, and they scream, they cry out, and all of a sudden, Peter says, "Man, that's not a ghost, that's Jesus." And so Peter says, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you." And Jesus says, "Come." Peter says, "Okay." And Peter gets out of the boat, and he begins to walk on the water. He begins to do something that is not natural and not normal for a human to do. He begins to do something that is beyond him. And this story kind of reminds me of when we go through hardships, when we go through trials, oftentimes God is going to require that we do things, that we go places that are way beyond us. And here's what happens with Peter, and I think here's what happens when we go through trials, is Peter all of a sudden realizes that he is going through something that is beyond him. And in the efforts of trying to get to Jesus, he loses his sight off of Jesus, and the Bible says that he begins to see the wind. In other words, he begins to see, how do you see the wind? You see it in the waves. You see how the waves are being picked up and they're stronger than ever before. And he loses his focus. And for a moment, he puts his focus off of Jesus and onto his circumstance. And he begins to realize that I am incapable of going through this. I am incapable of doing this thing. And he begins to sink that very moment. And here's what we need to understand. Is when God calls us to something that is beyond us, he is essentially calling us to himself. And sometimes we complain about, "God, why are you calling me to this? Why are you asking me to go through this? This is so much beyond me. This is way more than what I've studied for. This is way above my pay grade." And we don't understand that if God does not call us to things that are beyond ourselves, he will stop calling us to himself. And so, And so he says that there is something inside of you that needs to be accomplished. In other words, in trials, in order for God to maximize what he wants to get out of you, he has to press you and squeeze you. And pain and trials have a way of accelerating growth and maturity. Have you ever found out that when you go through some hard stuff, you learn real quick? Amen? You learn really, really quick. But here's what I want you to know, that hard times are not an indication of God's absence in your life. But they are an indication that God wants to bring something out of you that you yourself didn't even know was in you. And here's where the perspective needs to shift. Is instead of saying, look at what I'm going through, or when we go out of a trial, saying, look at what I've gone through, we need to start asking the question, what did I leave with? When we come out of a trial, we need to ask the question, what did I leave with? And when we're in a trial, we need to ask the question, what am I going to leave with? Because God is far more interested, church, and we need to grasp this, far more interested in developing you and maturing you and bringing you closer to the image of Jesus than anything else. In fact, I would argue, biblically speaking, that is his greatest purpose for your life. Romans chapter 8. He predestined us that we would be justified and that we would be glorified so that we would conform to the image of Christ. That is his ultimate purpose. And here's what we need to understand, because we need to shift our theology and we need to understand that God not only adds to our life, but sometimes he subtracts. God not only adds to our life, but sometimes he subtracts. And sometimes to change the trajectory of our life, God will actually give us things we don't like. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, you don't have to go there, but Paul is encouraging these Thessalonians about going through this hard time. And he's saying that you're actually going through this trial to be made worthy of the calling of God. What I find very interesting is that Paul does not pray for their deliverance. Don't you find that interesting? Like, if you're reading that letter as a part of the church member in that church, wouldn't you say, Paul, you're my apostle. Like, man, why don't you get a little charismatic and start praying for my deliverance? And here's what we don't understand, and here's what I think Paul understood while he went through all the suffering that he went through, and here's what he understood. He understood that sometimes we pray that God would deliver us out of the very things that God actually wants us to go through so that we would become all that God wants us to be. And we actually ask God to deliver us from the things that will help us get closer to him. And the question I think we need to start asking is, what type of attention can I bring to Jesus through this? When I went through my last 2 years of Bible college, I ended up doing a victory lap. Instead of graduating in 4 years, I graduated in 5. And I didn't get to graduate with my friends that I met in first year. And you know, they had a celebration party and I wasn't there. And it was a hard thing to go through, but it was tough because I understood that had to happen because I was going through some hard stuff. Mentally and emotionally, I just felt like I wasn't all there. And I began to see even a counselor and all these things. But one of the greatest things that happened is that God, through the Holy Spirit, in some miraculous way, gave me the ability to ask God the question, God, how can I glorify you through this? In other words, what am I not seeing that I need to see? How can you rearrange my perspective? How can you rearrange where my focus is so that I can see your hand in this situation, not only in my circumstance, but in me? And I remember praying these exact words, God, if it helps me become more like Jesus, then let me go through. challenging circumstance, every hardship is a new way for you and I to glorify God. And when we make that our primary goal and our primary joy, you and I can go through anything life throws at us. All of the lemons, and we can make lemonade. Here's what I want to end, because I want to talk about producing. The word producing, I can get it here, means this: to cultivate, to prepare something or someone for use, especially by working it like soil or squeezing it like lemons. And so when I squeeze this, let me see if I could do this. Actually, never used one of these in my life. When I squeeze this, I'm not squeezing it just for the sake of squeezing it. I'm squeezing it because I have use for it. I'm squeezing it because I realize that there is something greater I can make with this lemon when I squeeze it in some water and I add some sugar and I mix it. And all of a sudden, what the devil meant for evil, God will use for good. What the devil meant to leave a sour taste in your mouth, God will leave a sweet taste in your mouth. And all of a sudden, in the circumstances where I would be focusing on the hardships of life and the evil circumstances around me, all of a sudden I do what the psalmist said in Psalms 119, I fix my gaze on the person of Jesus. I fix my gaze and I meditate my heart on the word of God. And the Bible says that the word of God is as sweet or as sweeter than honey, which means that though I'm in a circumstance where I feel like I'm eating lemon wedges, I can actually have the ability to taste something sweet. Watch this. I want to read James again for you, but I want to read it out of the Message paraphrase. He says this. He says, you know that under pressure, your faith life is forced into the open, and your faith life shows its true colors. Listen to this. So don't try to get out prematurely. Let it do its work so you become mature and well-developed, not deficient in any ways. And here's my point, because when it talks about producing, understanding that you are being prepared for greater use, that you are building character, which we said was dependability. So God is going to depend on you for greater things as he produces you for greater things. And what we need to understand is that as God is trying to squeeze us and as God is trying to prune us, we cannot opt out prematurely. Otherwise, we won't let it have its full effect. And here's what happens. God tries to show us, yes, I squeezed something out of you, but there is way more inside of you than you ever thought. And if you would just be patient and understand that trials and hardships are producing something inside of you that are going to bring out of you something you did not even know was inside of you, you will understand that there is a greater purpose, there is a greater calling, and there is a greater reason for why you are going through what you are going through, but you cannot opt out prematurely. I think that's what God is. God is trying to tell us tonight is that in order for us to make lemonade out of the lemons life gives us, we need to fall in love with the process of maturing in Christ. We need to fall in love with the idea of glorifying God in new and in crazy ways. Ways that we never thought we could glorify him in. And when we fall in love with that and we understand that this is the process that he is taking us through, the ultimate goal becomes becoming more like Jesus. That's lesson one. And really, this is the goal of trials and sufferings in our life, that we would become mature. And over the next few weeks, we're going to talk a little bit about the individual aspects of maturity. But I want to leave you with this thought, and that is, are you asking the right questions? As you go through hard times, are you asking the right questions? Would you pray with me? Father, thank you so much for our time here tonight. Thank you for the space that you've created, the moments we share. And Lord, we just ask, Father, that you would give us the ability, the supernatural ability, God, to be so fixed on that goal of maturing and becoming more like Jesus. God, allow us to see that there are things inside of us that you want to bring out, that you want to develop, that you want to shape, that you want to mold. And Father, let us not run away prematurely as you try to prune us, as you try to squeeze us, God. And we know that it is uncomfortable and it is hard and it is tough. But I pray that you would give us the ability, the courage, the boldness to ask the right questions. What are you trying to do, Lord? And how can I glorify you through this? Father, I ask that you be with every single person that is in this room, every single person that watched online. Father, we ask for endurance. We ask for character. We ask for hope. We ask again for a reminder that we have been poured over by your love and your grace and your mercy. And all God's people said, amen and amen. God bless you, church. We'll see you Sunday morning.